My name is Scarlett Lewis, and I'm the founder of the Jesse Lewis Choose Love movement. And I'm here today to give you a talk on choosing love, to talk about the program, how it can benefit you as an educator, your students, and actually you as an individual as well. Thank you so much for agreeing to spend this time with me. I'm so appreciative and actually so honored. We give you our most precious asset for the majority of the day and ask you to help shape and mold them into the human beings they're going to become. Thank you for making the world a safer, more peaceful, and loving place every single day by your actions. I started the Jesse Lewis Choose Love movement as a way for everyone to come together to be part of the solution. It doesn't matter where you are politically, we are all connected as human beings by the want and need to love and be loved. In this way, we are all the same. It doesn't matter how old we are, how young we are, we're all human beings and we all have the want and need to love and be loved. And frankly, a lot of what we're seeing in our schools and in society is simply lack of love. And this empowering concept that we're going to talk about today is the fact that we can choose love. I know everyone's feeling a little bit of anxiety these days around personal safety and other things that are going on in our world. And the opposite of anxiety is action. And this is a way that we can all come together to be part of the solution. Love those moves. Awesome, Jess. It is August 24th, 2012. And Jess has brand new soccer shoes.
So prior to 12/14/2012, I was a single mom with two boys. It was kind of an unremarkable life. It was such a great life. You know, I just wanted to be a mom, and I just wanted to be with my kids.
Run the ball up to me.
One day, you're a mom with two boys, one boy riding in a car seat in the back seat. So one morning, I'm holding hands with my six-year-old in his car seat, and the next thing that I know,
cut.
There is no six-year-old. He's been murdered. So I had come home for the first time and I was getting Jesse's clothes for the funeral. And I walked through the kitchen on my way out and I noticed these three words that Jesse had written on the kitchen chalkboard shortly before he died. He wrote, nurturing, healing, love. These words were a message of comfort for his family and friends and inspiration for the world. It's where we needed to turn. And I knew I'd be spending the rest of my life spreading this message. I didn't have to create a solution. There was one available, and it's called social emotional learning. And social emotional learning proactively prevents violence. I believe that Jesse is a part of this organization. I actually believe that he's leading it. And all I have to do is just be present. I live with a tremendous dichotomy in my life every single day. It's never out of my mind why I am leading a worldwide movement to choose love. It's because my six-year-old son was shot in his first grade classroom alongside 19 of his classmates in one of the worst mass murders in U.S. history. I feel like I meet Jesse a lot in schools. I'll look into a child's eyes and I'll see Jesse looking back at me. And how blessed am I? And how grateful I am that my purpose is spreading a message of choosing love and given to me by my 6-year-old son. I like to follow that video up with a quote by Nelson Mandela. People must learn to hate. You know, it's kind of interesting because people will come up to me still to this day and say, wow, that guy that murdered your son, he snapped. And you know what? I have to say, it's never a snap. It is always a long, slow, steady burn of pain, disconnection, isolation, neglect, and suffering that leads to somebody doing something so heinous. And actually, that's a positive statement because there's always something that we can do to help ease another's pain. So back to the quote, people must learn to hate. And by the way, there is no mass murderer gene, right? Babies aren't born and we don't say, oh, what a cute baby. Too bad they're going to grow up to be a mass murderer. People are cultivated into what they become by their environment. And who's in their environment but we are? And we have a lot of power to really cultivate positivity. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. So if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love. For love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposite. So it all started for me with this chalkboard message that Jesse left shortly before he died. He wrote 3 words on our kitchen chalkboard: nurturing, healing, love. Now, those words aren't in the vernacular of a 6-year-old. They're not something a 6-year-old would normally say. They're phonetically spelled because he was in first grade and just learning how to write. But the meaning for me when I saw this message was clear. First of all, I knew instantly that if the shooter had been able to give and receive nurturing, healing, love, then the tragedy would never have happened. So I actually was connected to Dr. Chris Cook, who is a professor at Western Connecticut State University. He's actually the director of the Compassion, Creativity, and Innovation Center there and the author of The Compassionate Achiever. I invited him over and I said, Dr. Cook, look at this message. Is there a deeper meaning? I know what it means to me, but I feel like there's something else in there. He went back to his office and called me about 24 hours later and he said, those 3 words are in the definition of compassion across all cultures. And together we broke down the meaning and we found that it comprised a powerful and profound formula for choosing love in any situation or circumstance. Nurturing, healing, love. So nurturing means loving kindness and gratitude. Healing literally means forgiveness. And love is compassion in action. When you have the courage to practice each of those 3 character values in that order, and by the way, that's neuroscientifically accurate, you are choosing love. You have to have courage to be grateful, especially when things in life aren't going your way. You need courage to forgive, especially when the person who hurt you isn't sorry. And you need courage to step outside of the busyness and distraction and even pain of your own life to help someone else. And when you have the courage to practice those 3 character values in that order, you're choosing love. The Choose Love Enrichment Program actually is a program for a lifespan, focusing on infant, toddler, pre-K through 12th grade and an at-home program. This program was written by educators for educators, and it's the only program of its kind.
We put the best of the best of what is statistically effective and being taught in some classrooms today. We made it pretty short, powerful lessons with very little teacher prep. Remember, educators wrote this. And we made it a lot of fun, and I think you're really gonna be excited when you finally download it and check out what's available. We included social-emotional learning, positive psychology, mindfulness, neuroscience, emotional intelligence, character education, all on a base of post-traumatic growth research. The whole movement to choose love started at Jesse's funeral when I got up to speak. And of course, everyone on that day was saying, "What can we do for you?" And I said, "There is actually something that you can do." This whole tragedy started with an angry thought in the shooter's head. And I pictured him as a little boy having an angry thought without the tools or nurturing environment to handle that thought. We know through research and neuroscientific research that everything starts with a thought in our head, right here. Anger starts with a thought. Joy starts with a thought. Our perception of our reality starts with a thought. Bottom line is this: we all have around 60 to 70,000 thoughts a day. And we know through research that 70 to 80%, so the majority of our thoughts, are negative on a daily basis. That means angry, non-productive, and don't serve us. And furthermore, we know that over 90% of our thoughts are repetitive. That means the same thoughts we had yesterday, a week ago, a year ago, up to 5 years ago. So when you know that your perception of your reality starts right here, and every single thought you have impacts you on a cellular level, that means physically, mentally, and emotionally, it really makes you want to be mindful of what you're putting in your head, because every thought is a choice. So the whole tragedy started with a thought. And the amazing thing about that is a thought can be changed. So I asked everyone that day at Jesse's funeral to start thinking about what they think about and to change one angry thought a day into a loving thought. I said, by doing that, you will positively impact yourself, those around you, and through the ripple effect, you will make this a safer, more peaceful, and loving world. After the funeral, everyone went off to the four corners of the United States, and I know they were listening to me, because about a week later, they started calling me, emailing me, texting me, telling me that that one simple act had completely changed their life. And I knew that I was onto something. And actually, that was my idea for the movement to choose love. And then I got educators involved, and they are the ones that blew the roof off of this whole movement and made it a worldwide movement to choose love. That's why I'm here. That's why you're listening to this film. So this isn't a novel concept, actually. In the mental health field, it's called the cognitive triangle. Our thoughts impact our feelings that then impact our behavior. So if we have loving, kind, caring, compassionate thoughts, we feel good, and that's reflected in our behavior towards others and towards ourselves. If we have angry, resentful, and hateful thoughts, then we don't feel well. And that too is reflected in how we treat ourselves and others. The point is to have loving, kind, compassionate thoughts so that we can feel good and so that we can choose love in every situation and circumstance and even interaction. I love this quote by Viktor Frankl because I think it really perfectly sums up what we're trying to do in the Choose Love movement. So Viktor Frankl was a Nazi German concentration camp prisoner. He was brought to the camp in a cattle car along with members of his family in World War II. When his family members and himself and the rest of the people from the cattle car got off, his family members were taken and immediately gassed, murdered. Viktor Frankl's life was retained because he was a psychiatrist, and the Nazis thought that they could use his degree in some way. But what Viktor Frankl did in his years of internment in the concentration camp was he used that time as an experiment. And he watched how people who had everything taken from them, they had their families taken from them, They had all of their material possessions. They were beaten and tortured. They were stripped of their clothing and dignity. And he found that they had one freedom left. And that was how they chose to respond, even in that situation. And he found that those that chose kindness, caring, concern, compassion, they chose love. They not only survived better, but they survived longer. So here's the quote. Between stimulus, and stimulus is what happens to us in life. And by the way, it can be anything. It can be anything that's ever happened to you or anything that ever will happen to you. And our response. And that is our thoughtful response, by the way, not impetuous reaction. There's a space. In that space lies our freedom and power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and freedom. So in other words, it's really not about what happens to us in life, because we're all going to have our pain. Even when I'm in elementary schools and I happen to ask kindergarten through fifth grade if they're in a room, I say, do you have your stuff? Do you have your pain? Do you have things going on in your life that make you feel bad? Oh yeah, they know what I'm talking about. And you educators, you know what I'm talking about. We all have our stuff. It's really not about what happens to us. That's not the narrative. That's not what shapes and molds us. It's how we choose to respond to what happens to us in life. That is what shapes and molds us as human beings. When we choose love in our response, we are taking our personal power back and we're making the world a better place. When we react with anger, hatred, and resentment, we are giving our personal power away. We are becoming victims and we are not adding value to our world. Do you know a third of all healings are actually due to the placebo effect? That's the power of our minds over our bodies. We see that also in the nocebo effect. That's the opposite. When there have been circumstances where a patient has been given the wrong diagnosis and said that they had terminal cancer and given a death sentence and told, you need to go home, get your affairs in order because you're going to be dead within 3 months. So they go home, they get their affairs in order, and lo and behold, they die within 3 months. But then there's an autopsy performed on the body and there is no sign of disease. Our thoughts are so powerful. Our thoughts shape our reality. And we're going to learn in this program how to choose love with our thoughts. When I realized following Jesse's murder that I wanted to be part of the solution to the issues that we're experiencing, not only in our schools, but then that translate out into our society, little did I realize that some of the issues that have been around since I was in school are still around, but now at epidemic proportions. Let's take a look at some of these. We know that 49.5% of our U.S. youth will have had a diagnosable mental illness by the time they're 18. The majority of that diagnosis is anxiety. The average onset age for anxiety is 6 years old, and we know that roughly 70% of those kids will not get professional help, so they suffer alone. And it's so interesting when you look at the long-term outcomes of untreated anxiety. They're exactly what we're seeing in our society. They're more mental illness, substance abuse, suicide, depression, incarceration, anger and violence, homelessness. We know trauma in schools has increased exponentially. So 20 years ago, there was a groundbreaking research study done on childhood trauma. It was called the ACEs study, Adverse Childhood Experiences. In this study, they found that 1 in 5 kids was coming to school traumatized. Today, there's recent research out by Clifford Beers that shows that that number is more like over 50%. That means that over 50% of the kids in your classroom are coming to school having experienced a recent traumatic event, at least one. But keep in mind that trauma can be anything from yelling and screaming at home to the unthinkable. We know that bullying has increased since we started tracking it in 2003. You're probably aware of these statistics. 77% of students are bullied mentally, physically, and verbally. 160,000 kids stay home from school each day for fear of being bullied. And 1 in 10 students drops out altogether because of bullying. And by the way, this is seemingly, despite our best efforts, it's not like we haven't addressed this problem. It was around when I was in high school, and we've created state laws. We have anti-bullying programs that every child has to go through. Everybody has to learn the definition of a bully. Yet still, we see it continuing to increase. We know that there are more suicides in the U.S. than murders, despite state-mandated suicide prevention programs. We also know that substance abuse is skyrocketing. There were more deaths from drug overdoses last year than ever before, and we know that that number is expected to escalate over the next 5 years. This, despite mandated substance abuse awareness programs that every child has to go through, that we spend as taxpayers billions of dollars on per year. Why do we do drugs? We do drugs because we're trying to reduce our anxiety. We're trying to find connection through perhaps fitting in instead of the true belonging. And we know that violence, unfortunately, is increasing in our schools and in our society. We've had a school-related shooting every other day, and we've had a mass shooting in our society every single day. Almost 6 years ago, when my personal tragedy happened, I started saying, this can't be our new normal. And now, around 6 years later, I'm here to tell you this is our new normal, but it still can't be. Schools must be safe havens for our kids and our educators. So why are all of these issues escalating? I mean, nobody wants to see anybody suffer. So many people dedicate so much time to preventing all of these issues from happening. Why are they continuing to get worse? Well, each and every one of us is born with a negative bias. So think about the thoughts that we have on a daily basis, the majority of which are negative. Why is that? Well, actually, there's a very good reason for that. It's to keep us safe. So let me give you an example. Let's go all the way back to caveman times. And so, because I'm a woman, you see a cave woman sitting on the outside of a cave, totally zenned out, mindful, eyes shut. And then you have another cave woman on the other side of the cave, scanning for a saber-toothed tiger. Who is gonna live to pass down their genes? Well, if you ask kids, they'll say, the meditator. But we know it's the scanner. The scanner is going to live to pass down their genes. And that's the mentality that we continue to have today, despite the fact that there aren't saber-toothed tigers lurking behind every bush. And I'm not saying we shouldn't be aware of danger. We absolutely should. But we have this negative bias. And some of the programming that we have put in place is actually focused on this. And so we focus on the negative. Let me give you another example of our negative bias. So, have you ever heard of PTSD? You're probably thinking, oh, is she serious? Yeah, of course I've heard of PTSD, because we've all heard of PTSD, right? Now I'm gonna ask you another question. Have you ever heard of PTG? PTG, what is PTG? Well, PTG is the upside of trauma. PTG stands for post-traumatic growth, and it's when we actually grow through trauma. We find strength we never knew we had. We strengthen relationships, weed out weak ones, gain a new perspective, deepen our spirituality, find meaning in our suffering, maybe even find a purpose in life. So many benefits to post-traumatic growth, yet almost no one that I know has ever heard of it. But of course, we've all heard of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, but it's so interesting. Both, by the way, are thoroughly researched. 7% of the total population will suffer from PTSD at one point in their life. But the vast majority of us experience something called post-traumatic growth, following trauma, following difficulty, roadblocks, pain. It's what shapes and molds us as a human being. Think about it. Do we make the hard changes we need to make? Are we shaped and molded when things are going our way? when, let's picture a birthday party, when you've got all your family and friends around you, you're getting all the presents that you want, you're stuffing your face with cake and ice cream. Is that when you grow as a human being? It's great connection, but no. Actually, we grow through difficulty. We grow through roadblocks, through challenges, through pain and suffering. That's how we're shaped and molded. How we choose to respond in those situations, that is what shapes and molds us. So now picture with me a generation of kids that have this seed of awareness of PTG planted in their head. And it's not difficult. So you say, things are going to happen in life. You're going to have pain. You're going to have suffering. You're going to have roadblocks and difficulties. There are lessons in every single one for you. What we want to do is take out the fear. We want to cultivate a generation of kids that are courageous and can turn to things that happen to them in life and look at them with almost curiosity and say, what are the lessons in here for me? Rather than fear them, which means they resist and avoid. We know that bad things happen when we resist and avoid reality in life. I love this quote by Helen Keller. Character cannot be developed in ease and quiet. Only through experiences of trial and suffering can the soul be strengthened, vision cleared, ambition inspired, and success achieved. Now, following the Parkland shooting, that was a really difficult time for me. That was about 5 years following Sandy Hook, and I had a really hard time watching the news because on the news, they were saying the exact same things that they were saying following the tragedy at Sandy Hook. But in my mind, I was thinking, my gosh, it's been 5 years. How can we be talking about the same things, but we still have these tragedies happening? And my therapist actually walked me through an exercise, and now I walk everyone through this exercise because it really helped me figure out how we think as human beings. And so I want you to do it with me if you would. It just takes a minute. So I want you to think about a problem that you're having right now. Just off the top of your head, there's no right or wrong answer. Just think about a current problem that you're having. It shouldn't be that difficult. It shouldn't take you that long. Okay. Now, I want you to, if you have pen and paper, write down your thoughts and feelings about the problem that you identified. If you don't have pen and paper, just mentally list the thoughts and feelings about the problem that you identified in your head. 3 to 5 thoughts and feelings about the problem that you identified. I'll give you a few seconds to do that. Okay. You have your thoughts and feelings? All right. Now I want you to take your pen or your mental pen and circle the thoughts and feelings that are about a solution to the problem that you identified. Any? Any? Most likely not. Isn't that interesting? That really helped me understand why 5 years after Sandy Hook, we were still talking about the same things with no solution. Because if you don't identify the cause of why something is happening, then you certainly can't be talking about a solution. Today, together, we're going to be talking about a solution to the issues that we've been discussing. I also might ask you, who is going to fix this? Who is going to fix this long list of issues that we've been through, that we've been experiencing since we were kids in schools, but just getting worse now? Actually, many of which are at epidemic proportions. Who is going to fix this? Are politicians going to fix this? No, because these are not political issues. These are issues of the heart, and we all have to take responsibility for what's going on in our society. And in that way, we can all be part of the solution.